Your knowledge is free. Your world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow mystic walls. Your words come out from the depths of truth, by timeless striving, strengthening sounds towards perfection. But the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary deserts and upland highways. But the mind is led forward by thee into ever widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my father and my teacher. Respected teachers, elders, and my dear young friends, I offer my obeisance to Ma Saraswati, and I really invoke her blessings that for next few minutes may she decide on my tongue, and whatever I say be inspiring and motivating not only for you but for me as well. Friends, Swami Vivekananda once said, give me a handful of you and I turn the destiny of this country. While I don't claim that I am Swami Vivekananda, but when I stand here in front of you, I can see that power which can change and transform this country. And what brings me over here is to sort of help you to invoke that power within you so that you can shape the future of this country. You can power the destiny of this country. And believe you me, friends, it's absolutely possible. I haven't come here to sort of give you any kind of a sermon, or I haven't come here to sort of educate you or enlighten you, but I've just come over to sort of share some of my thoughts with you and then sort of do some kind of an exchange of thoughts and conversation, because I believe you guys are far more intelligent, far more capable, and far more smart than what the previous generation was all about. And I also believe that you're absolutely fortunate to be living in a time in this country where this country is going through a very, very massive transformative phase. And you have an opportunity to build and construct not only the future of your country, but your own destiny as well. And that's why I'm over here, to sort of share some thoughts. And I think after sharing my thoughts, I would like to have this conversation with you, a dialogue, which is not a kind of a Q&A, because value is a subject where you don't have any right answers or a wrong answer. It's all a question of what you believe has to be done at that point in time and what you believe is right. Lokmanya Tilak once said, Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it. And again, I'm not sort of trying to put myself in the shoes of that great Indian leader, Tilak, but I want to really tell today that prosperity is our birthright and we shall have it. We all want our nation to be prosperous, and I believe we can fundamentally achieve that prosperity, not only for ourselves, but for millions of people who are there. Let me tell you one thing, my friends. We all go through enough challenges in life, and I'm sure when exams come, you think, oh my God, why this teacher sent such a complicated paper? Oh my God, how am I going to study? Oh my God, my parents don't understand me. Oh my God, I just can't go out and have good time with my friends, right? All these questions come in our mind, and depending upon which stage of life you are, this question can sort of take a turn. Maybe 5 years down the line, you'll not be bothered about those night parties, but you'll be much bothered about whether you're getting your next promotion or not. So the questions never leave you at all. But then, in the midst of all these questions, let me tell you that each one of us sitting in this room is an absolute privileged person. The reason why I'm saying is just one data, one statistic that I want to share with you. 20% of our population lives below poverty line. And poverty line, as defined by Government of India, is anyone who earns less than 32 rupees on a daily basis. Imagine it takes you almost 25 rupees to come from station to here if you come by an auto. And Government of India defines that anyone less than 32 rupees is below poverty line. The reason why I'm saying that we are all privileged people is just look at some of the simple joys of life that you and I can experience. We can eat food whenever we want to. We can go to reasonably any kind of restaurant we want to. We are privileged to be in an august institution like this Birla College, and I have great fond memories of meeting Sri Basant Kumar Birla once at the airport, me along with his wife, and they were like so humble, so you know, they were sort of, I think, taking a flight from Mumbai to Calcutta, and I just sort of approached Sri Birla again. I said, sir, I just want to take your blessing. And he sort of hugged me, not even knowing me, he just sort of took me in his arms and said, young boy, be successful in life. You know, that's the kind of institution we are coming and studying. What more we can aspire for? What more we can ask for? The kind of privileges that each one of you sitting in this room has is simply unimaginable. The question is today, how do we leverage those privileges? How do we see that whatever life has offered to us, how do we sort of mold ourselves, how do we shape ourselves, and how do we formulate ourselves to sort of launch into the ever-growing successful path of life? One of the things, the topic which was given to me was value-based education. And I believe that I can share some thoughts on this particular topic because I did my MBA from a university called Shukrutisa Institute of Higher Learning. It's in Kodapati, Andhra Pradesh. One of the very unique features of this particular university or the whole education system over there is right from KG to PG, that's the kind of acronym we use, kindergarten to postgraduation. The institute doesn't charge even a single naya paisa. You don't have to pay any fees, no admission fees, no tuition fees, no examination fees, nothing. The whole education system over there is free. Not only that, the only thing you end up paying is for your hostel, boarding and lodging charges, which when I was studying during 95-97 was a meager 250 rupees per month. Imagine 250 rupees per month for staying, for food and everything. But then, this institute expects a very different kind of a discipline. A discipline where you are not allowed to sort of go out of the whole campus. You couldn't sort of walk into any restaurant and have food. An institute where even the incoming periodicals are being sort of, if I may use the word, censored. And an institute where even an MBA student or an MTech student or a PhD scholar is expected to get up at 5:30 in the morning, attend prayers, then go to college and in the evening go to temple and then come back and by 8:10-30 lights are off. You're not allowed to sort of stay back like in 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock and have a great time. And imagine this is, I'm talking about an MBA institute. And the reason why that university, you may agree or you may disagree, and the reason why that university follows such a regimented pattern is that it believes that for the amount of time a student comes inside that campus, they are working on that particular student as part of the process. And when you have, I'm sure some of you may have some basic understanding of chemistry, when a process is going on, you cannot interfere that process with an external element unless and until it is required, for otherwise the whole process would go for a toss. We all know the process of milk becoming a curd. Mother would have said, hey, don't disturb that. The curd will not have a good formation, right? Simple process of milk getting into a curd. And that's what that whole university believes, that the students who come here, they have come with a certain purpose in mind, certain objective in mind, and we need to provide them with an environment which is non-destructive. So right from the type of food we eat to the kind of entertainment we have, it's not that we were allowed to watch any or every kind of movies. Even that was restricted. And we were like 40 of us in the MBA program in that particular year. Every year they used to take about 40 students. We believed in that philosophy. We believed that if we have to sort of mold ourselves, if we have to sculpt ourselves, there is some kind of a sacrifice that we all have to do. I talked about the right that prosperity is going to be what we want to achieve, but with the right comes a lot of responsibility, with right comes a lot of duty, with right comes a lot of accountability. I just want to sort of share one thought with you, young friends. When we talk about values, imagine a situation that you are appearing for your annual examination or a class test and there is no English later standing. And can the college have that confidence that the students in this examination are not going to cheat? The students in this examination are not going to sort of peek into each other's question paper. The students in this examination are not going to take anyone's help for that matter. It's a very simple thing, right? Nothing complicated, where you don't need an individual. But imagine if a situation like that comes in this country, you have seen those videos in television. In some of the states, what happens when it comes to cheating? Parents almost help students to cheat in the exam, right? I'm sure you might have seen those videos on television. They climb a couple of stories of buildings and sort of give all those examination answers. But imagine what kind of student is going to come out of that. Imagine if you were to become a professional, and I'm sure most of you are from management background, right? All of you rather than you are. Let's say you are going to become a CEO of a company that you are going to start. and there is a guy who is coming and you are going to interview that guy, and you find that that guy with some mechanism has managed to give an answer, but when it comes to performance, he's not able to deliver because he has cheated. What kind of trust or faith do we have in your employees going forward? Put yourself in that particular shoe. So these values are not some esoteric science, these values are not some esoteric philosophy that I'm going to talk about. Values are very simple. Values are those things that make us a good human being, period. So whether we are sitting in an examination hall where teachers can trust us, and rather, I believe you should take up this as an experiment and as a project for your next examination, where you should tell your teacher that please don't stand here, trust us, we will not cheat. And trust me guys, the kind of confidence and the kind of respect that the teachers are going to have on you after this particular small act is going to come. But more than that, the kind of respect that you yourself are going to have on yourself is going to be phenomenal. Let me narrate one very small instance from my life that happened just about last year. You know, in Mumbai, we all live in societies, and societies have an annual general meeting, right? And some of the societies are kind enough to sort of sponsor some snacks or dinner or high tea or whatever it is after the AGM is done. Our society also was sort of kind enough to sponsor a dinner, and as it happens, to ensure that there is not much misuse, they issued coupons or token to each of those flat, two coupons for happening. So after the meeting is over, I go to the area where, you know, this dinner is served, and I had forgotten to carry my coupon at that point in time. So there's this guard who is always there in our building. He's standing there collecting coupons, and I say, sorry, I just forgot to bring it. So you know, in a very polite manner, he says, but sir, aapko to coupon lana padega, uske bigger to main aapko entry nahi kar sakta. So I said, I'm just requesting you, I'm a little hungry, let me have it, and I go and get back the coupon for you. And at that moment, this guard doesn't ask me any further questions. He trusts and he says, okay, theek hai sir, aap jaiye, aap khana kha lijiye. I have my meals, I come back, go. And I said, jaane do bhaiya, kya hai, khana to kha liya, ek coupon se kya farak padega. You know, that's the kind of thought that is going on in my mind. And then, you know, my wife also says, you know, you have to go out and get some stuff. And I'm like, oh, I have to anyway go out and I'm busy. Forget it, I don't want to go and get the coupon. Usko bhi kya yaad hai, how does it make a difference? And you know, in India, we have this whole tendency and mentality. We treat guards and we treat the security people or the bus wala or the auto wala as if, you know, they are not human beings at all. They don't mean any respect. But trust me guys, when you travel abroad, I've been to almost 15 countries across the world. And the kind of respect that one human being gives to another human being, irrespective of the profession, is phenomenal. You get into a bus in the United States, that driver, because there are no conductors in the bus, the driver is a conductor, he gives the ticket and he allows you to get in. He is the master of that bus, he is the captain, he is the driver. And you better not mess with him, as simple as that. It is absolutely polite, and the kind of respect he expects from you is the same respect that he gives you. Anyway, coming back to the original story, so I said, as it happens, kya hai, guard hai, kya farak padta hai, so many days long. But something in my mind said, no. That guy trusted me, and based upon that trust, I cannot let him down, irrespective of what position he might be. So I go back, give him a coupon, he just looks at me, smiles, and keeps it. The story doesn't end here, my dear friends. The story continues. And how does it continue? After a couple of days, that guard is posted at the gate where everyone enters and exits. And when I pull in my vehicle, he looks at me and he smiles. And trust me, that smile meant a lot of things. It meant, sir, I respect you because you trusted me. It meant, sir, welcome inside. It meant, sir, you are one of the honorable person, whatever it could be. But imagine, if I had not given that coupon back to him, and if he had looked in my eyes, I would have crestfallen shame. Not because he was a guard and I sort of did not keep my word, but the fact that someone trusted me and life, and I had his trust down. And friends, till day, I really thank my stars that on that day, some good thinking, some sadbuddhi came in my mind, and I did not allow my laziness or my values to sort of fall down. And that happened, I would have sort of fallen in my own heart. And friends, let me tell you, values are not something, you know, which are very complicated, which is like, oh my God, this is like a career decision which I have to take. No. Values are like your life breath. It's something which walks much more profoundly than your own shadow. And you would not realize maybe the importance of what value means at this point in time, because you are all spotless. You are all shining with very fine character at this point in time. But when the challenges of life come in front of you, that's when you will encounter what value means. And the value and the credibility that you build is not done overnight. It takes years and years of effort. Today, if I give you the names of 5 corporates from this particular country, and among those 5 corporates, I don't want to give the name of another 4, but if I put a word like Tata, what does it stand for? It stands for credibility, right? It's a 24-karat gold standard that you would say no. A company like Tata, I believe in them. I believe that what they are going to do is going to be right. When I throw a name like Mr. Narayan Murthy again, a very different kind of feeling comes in your mind. And I don't want to talk about other names, because we all have to be a little more positive in our approach towards life. Why does that happen? As the same country which is sort of plagued with so much of corruption and hypocrisy and what not. But why is it when the name of Mr. Narayan Murthy comes, or when the name of Mr. Tata comes, our heart really swells in pride? It doesn't happen overnight, right? They have built their legacy over a period of time which sort of tested them. I am sure in their life, there could have been many a times they would have encountered a situation where a shortcut, what we say, jugadu, right? In India, we have more than a word famous for jugadu. We are jugadu karlokulti, you know? And recently, I read a very interesting statement from Anand Mahindra, chairman of Mahindra and Mahindra, and CEO of Mahindra and Mahindra, who said, boss, I think this word jugad and jugadu has to be taken away from our dictionary. And the word that needs to come in a typical Mumbai lingo, he says, chakas. You know, let us all be chakas in life. Let us not be jugadu. And trust me, I believe in that. What does jugadu mean? You have just sort of done some kind of a management. You have done some kind of a manipulation. Do you think a company like Microsoft could have been built by jugads? Do you think a company like Facebook or WhatsApp could have been built by jugads? Do you think a company like Google or Oracle could have been built by jugads? Do you think Tata would have built their legacy by jugad? Do you think Infosys could have been built by jugad? Not at all. All these companies have been built by hard work. You cannot pass your examination by jugad. You may be taking those small cheat sheets or whatever you call, you know, exam aali hai ya, mere to pure saal padhai nahi ki, chalo, kuch ek concise notes le lete, ek summary le lete hai, kisi se kuch mark lete, but trust me, friends, it's not going to help you. Because the knowledge that you are taking is not to pass an exam. I think those days are over. Maybe when you are in first standard, second standard, third standard, you want to sort of just get from one standard to another, one class to another. But today, when you are in an undergraduation program, when you are going to sort of aspire to go to maybe one of those foreign universities, maybe to Harvard, maybe to Stanford, maybe to MIT, maybe to Sloan, why not? It's absolutely possible. Imagine when you are going to be in the league of those students who are coming from all across the world, and they ask you simple concepts of accountancy or management, and you're sort of blinking. Why? Because you are distinction holder in your examination, because you managed the exam. You did some kind of a jugaad during the exam. But when the testing time came, when the time for delivery, when the time of performance came, you think, you feel that you have fallen short. At that point in time, trust me, friend, you will curse yourself. Arey, I'm very so jugaad. Hard work, friends, is one of those values which has got absolutely no substitute at all. I think it was Thomas Edison who said, life is all about 99% perspiration and 1% inspiration, right? It has happened with me. I thought I am not a very smart guy. When I say smart, I am a very intelligent guy. I am not a kind of an IIT kind of a person. I cannot sort of crack things up. And then, because of that, I always felt that, you know, how am I going to sort of grow up in my career? How am I going to grow up in my life? And when an opportunity from a company like Microsoft came, I could make it, because I had a belief in myself and I had that faith in myself. And trust me, guys, in life, when you go across, you will realize that it's not about talent, it's not about whether you are smart or not, it's not about whether you are intelligent or not, but it's all about are you ready to slog it or not. There is nothing called smart work, everything is hard work. I'm sort of reminded of a very beautiful statement from Rajiv Bajaj. He's a CEO of Bajaj. You don't find him in press many of time. He's a very reserved kind of a person who is sort of focused on running his company. He once said that if I don't work hard, I will not be able to attract talent who is going to work hard for me. He says, gone are the days when Lala Ji sat in the morning and came to the company and club mein chale jaate the. Those days are gone. If I slog for 12, 14, 15 hours, that's when smart employees are going to slog along with me. And when I say smart employees, not someone who is doing a jugaad, but someone who is going and building some stuff. Someone who is going and creating some stuff. And if you have to attract that kind of talent in your life, and I force you that all people, maybe about 200 people who are sitting in this room, you all have to be your future entrepreneurs. And you have to sort of build companies for yourself. You have to sort of, you know, create institutions for yourself. And you have to do it. You can't do it on your own. Trust me. Today, it's all about teamwork. Together, everyone achieves more, right? That's the kind of an acronym team stands for. If you have to attract that kind of a talent, you need to be that 24-karat gold standard. That people will say, nahi yaar, iske saath kaam karna hai. Is aadmi ke saath ya is mahila ke saath, this guy or this girl, I don't work with her. Why? Because she's so inspiring. And trust me, our Prime Minister talked about startup nation, stand-up nation, right? I've been to Israel, and Israeli country is known for being a startup nation. In a startup, when you start a company, you have nothing. What do you have? You don't even have a very crystallized idea, because your ideas are all in a very formative state. And at that point in time, you have to attract talent. And what is it that will attract talent for you? It's your own passion, it's your own commitment, it's your own dedication. If an employee comes and he sees that you come to office at 10:30, 11, 11:30, you go back 4:30, 5, every weekend you want to sort of go out, have holiday, you want to go out to Goa, you want to go out to some fancy location in Lonava, trust me, that guy is not going to work, even if you pay me. That's the reality of today's scene. I don't want to work for a person who is not putting equal amount of hard work. Why should I? Because we are here not for salary. Trust me, like, be completely relaxed that whether you will get job in your life or not, whether you will get good salary or not, that's going to happen. Take it from me. I'm going to give you some offer, not in terms of job offers, but something much more meaningful and beautiful in terms of how we can engage, and remind me if I forget to do that. Take it from me, guys. You are all going to earn good money in your life. I'm ready to sign that blank check and give it to you. Because I'm so confident, because the kind of opportunities this country is throwing up is phenomenal. Unheard of. Unheard of opportunities are coming in this particular country. Job to it is like, you know, you should take it here, it will be mega, it will be nice. Iske alawa kya, iske upar kya. What am I going to build upon it? Main apni company kaise banaunga? Main sab logon ko kaise employ karunga? That's the kind of thought process that should go in your mind. But for that to happen, you need to have a very strong, what I call, a courage, a conviction in your own self. And that courage and that conviction will come if your foundation is built upon values. It's not about the intellect, my friends. It's not about the knowledge. It's not about the talent. Let me give you a very little sorrowful situation. You have seen a lot of old people who suffer from some kind of mental disability. Maybe they have lost their memory, they have got Alzheimer or whatever it might be. But have you noticed that even those old people, they feel hungry, they need to be fed, they feel irritated, they need to be relaxed, they need to sleep, they need to get up. Maybe their cycle, the biological cycle is gone for a while, the feelings are still there. And at that moment in time, imagine ourselves, let's say 50 years down the line, be suffering from one of those mental diseases. God forbid that should not happen, but just visualize. And at that moment, if we have done something wrong in our life in the early days, it's going to haunt us, it's going to torment us. We may not be in the best of our senses, and that's why I said even intellect and knowledge is absolutely temporary. Just as wealth is temporary, just as money is temporary, even intellect and knowledge is temporary. What is going to stand with you at that point in time is your values. You will be reminded about each and every moment of your life when you did something wrong to another. And at that point in time, you will not have means to articulate it. You will not have means to confess it to someone, because you will feel the pain in yourself. But then your situation will be such Or our situation is going to be such that we are going to be completely hopeless. Gentlemen, if you don't mind, you can just sit as well. You don't have to stand.
Hey,
it's okay. As long as you do the recording and I can put it on a YouTube and it can show my young face. So the point that I'm going to drive home, friends, is that values are something is eternal, which is like a soul. It's going to be with us as long as we are going to live our life. Not only that, it's also going to be there when we leave our bodies. Because if you look at a company like Tata or some of the other companies, or even like, let's say, a company like Infosys going into a second generation of leadership, the companies which are built for 100 years and 150 years are the companies which have got legacy. And how is it that they have been able to build a legacy? Because the leadership which was there said, we stand for something. I want to sort of, you know, bring one point over here. It could be a little digression from the subject. Many a times, you know, when we go into a social setting, we are asked this question, who are you? Or what do you do in life? And you say, you know what? I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, I'm a private accountant, I'm an engineer, so on and so forth. Right? That's the kind of an answer we typically give. But today, friends, I want to think on this particular point. You may want to become a chartered accountant, you may want to become an MBA graduate, you may want to become a CFO of a company. If someone asks you, what do you do in life? Don't tell them what your profession is, but tell them what is the value that you are creating on your business. I tell myself, I'm not a digital marketing consultant, that's what my profession is. But my job is to help companies reach out with their beautiful products and services to the large audience so that many more people can enjoy from those good products and services. That's what my job is. And as that, I see how the products and services can go into each and every wallet or pocket or purse of a person. Today we all carry smartphones, right?
Yes.
The smartphone penetration in this country is going through the phenomenal experience that has happened. And over the next couple of years, there's going to be a phenomenal opportunity going to get generated. So if you want to reach out to masses, it's not going to be through television only, it's not going to be through newspaper, it's going to be through mobile phone. And that's how I describe myself. That my job is to create that value. For each one of you, I ask yourself, when you get into a profession, whatever it might be, don't tell people that, you know what, I work for so-and-so company and I'm a manager of supply or I'm a manager of finance over there. Tell them what value you are creating. As a finance guy, you'll be saying, you know what, I help my company manage the cash flows, or I help my company to ensure there are no frauds being committed. Maybe as an engineer, you will say, you know what, I help my company build bridges. I help my company construct beautiful houses. That's the kind of answer you must be giving. That reminds me of a very beautiful anecdote. There were a group of people and they were building something. Now, maybe let's say a palace, 300 years old, story kind of. And you know, passers-by would come and they would ask this particular person, hey, what are you doing? And someone said, you know what, I'm laying the bricks. Because so maybe he was constructing a palace, so as part of that he was laying them there. Said, okay, fine. Then that person goes and asks someone else, he said, what are you doing? He says, you know what, I'm building a wall. A little better answer. So first person was, he said, I'm just laying the brick. The second person said, I'm building a wall. And when he goes to a third person, who is, let's say, maybe an architect or someone, he says, what are you doing? He says, you know what? I'm building a beautiful palace over here where people can come and enjoy the conversations of life. Where the families are going to come together and they're going to have those great moments. Where, you know, the historians are going to come together and they're going to write the history of this particular country. Where great warriors are going to sit and say, you know what? How do we protect our empire and how do we protect our country? Now imagine, all three of them were doing more or less similar job in terms of, which was as basic as putting up bricks or as little higher end as putting up a wall or as big as putting up a palace where people are going to have conversations about life and living. Now, the approach that you bring in each of these three scenarios is going to have a very different kind of an output in what you want to deliver. Same is the case with you in case of your examination. You may say, you know what, I am studying to pass my examination. Someone will say, you know what, I am studying to get 75% or a distinction or a first rank, or I want to be a gold medalist in this. And someone can say, you know what, I am studying so that I can deliver value to my country. I am studying so that it helps me to be a good businessman and create business for my country and my community. And trust me, in each of these three situations, the approach that you are going to bring to your studies is going to be phenomenally different. Whether you achieve distinction or not, whether you achieve gold medal or not, that's a very secondary thing. That's a byproduct of the effort. It's like a lot of people who have told me many a times, even I have sort of stumbled and tumbled in the journey of my life. And I said, KK, you know what? The money that you want to make in your life, make that as a byproduct of what you want to do. And it's an extremely, extremely thought-provoking concept, you know. Let money be a byproduct. And trust me, all the people who have achieved any success in life, they have made for us what the goal looks like more as a means or as a byproduct. You know, that has never been an objective. And trust me, I have sort of struggled in my life many a times when I put things in a very wrong priority or a wrong perspective. The moment money became a priority for me, I realized that, you know, I had a very tormented period because I was chasing something which anyway has to happen and which anyway has to come in your life. It's just a question of time and it's just a question of some kind of a delay that would. If you are a smart person, if you are a good person, if you are a capable person, you will get things in life. Maybe not in this year, maybe after 2 years, maybe after 3 years, maybe 5 years. And that's why I said, life is a long journey, it's a marathon.